Hi guys, Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive Magazine, and today we're having a look at these new Evolution G4 wireless units from Sennheiser. These represent an upgrade to the now industry standard G3 Evolution wireless that everybody's been using for ages and ages. And on the test bench, we have the 100 series and the 500 series. We're going to compare the spec of these two in a little bit, but I am going to try and keep this as guitarist friendly as we can. So we're not going to get too deep into what makes this tick. We're going to listen more to how it sounds. We're going to do some comparisons against a cable and in some kind of situations that you might find yourself in. But let's talk about what goes into making these wirelesses first before we go. So you'll notice that they're both in rugged metal half rack size units. Really tough, really good looking things. They have these bright LED screens and we have kind of really easy interfaces to kind of navigate our way around. This little bit I'm going to show you there in a second is particularly useful. This is an infrared an infrared device that allows you to easily pair the transmitter, which is over here. The transmitters for both series are made of this really rugged metal, but they do both have a plastic battery door. That shouldn't pose any issue though, because the rest of it is really rather tough. They've got some particularly rugged clips, which we found out when we're trying to attach this to a strap, and that's really good news. That means it's not going to come flying off in the heat of battle. If we turn it this way, you'll notice I'm just going to screw this now. And it connects using an eighth inch TRS jack with a screw collar, which attaches there. Now you don't need to use a screw collar. You could use any eighth inch jack and that'll fit just fine. But the screw collar is just gonna mean that it's a little sturdier and it's not gonna pull out when you're on stage. And of course we have the regular normal TS quarter inch jack, which you'd expect to see for pretty much any guitar application at the other end. That does mean that you're going to need to use the included cable, and you're not just going to be able to use any old patch cable that you have lying around, but these parts should be fairly readily available if you wanted to make your own with, for example, a Neutrik silent jack on the end, which as I know is a very popular upgrade for many wireless systems. Now, before we get into the tones and we get into the differences between these two, just want to show you how easy it is to set this up. So looking at the 100, we're going to go into the menu by hitting set, and we have easy setup, which again, we'll hit set. We're going to hit current list, which is going to give us access to banks of presets. If we choose bank 2, for argument's sake, and we hit set, bank 2, preset 1, that's all stored now. And now we're operating at 6.1450 megahertz. Now if we take a look at our transmitter, you'll notice that's still set to the old frequency, but if we want to pair it up with our receiver, it's as simple as taking this little infrared doobly over here and putting it next to the infrared doobly over here. Okay, we'll hit sync over here to connect the two. This lights up. And as if by magic, we're on the new frequency, dead easy. And as if by magic, it's on the new frequency, dead easy. Now, in terms of connecting multiple systems, this is really where the 500 series shines, because you are able to connect more systems. Although you can have an impressive 20 systems operating at once on the 100, you can go up to 32 with this one, and there's an Ethernet connection on the back for connecting to the wireless system manager so that you can kind of control the frequencies that are in operation even more finely. Anyway, I gather, because you're all guitar players, and this is, after all, a guitar magazine, you want to know what it sounds like. So we're going to try some comparisons using various scenarios. We've plugged into an Orange TH30 and we're going to play it clean using first of all a cable, then the 100 series, then the 500 series, and we'll see if there's any difference in the sound. Let's try that now, and after we've done that we're going to look at some examples both dirty and with a vintage style fuzz. But first, clean. Thank you. So that's how the units sound clean. Probably what you can't pick up from that is the feel of the of playing through the wireless. It's really pretty much exactly the same as you'd expect to feel through a cable. I did notice that the 100 series is putting out a little more volume than the cable or the 500 series, and I'm sure that's something that you can adjust if you were to go in and fiddle with the internal parameters, but straight out of the box, it did give us a little bit of extra hotness. That's nothing to be concerned about though. You can definitely fix that if you so desire. And in fact, some great recordings have been made using wireless systems as boosters. For example, the guitar solo from Back in Black by AC/DC, which is a pretty mean tone, I'm sure you'll agree. Anyway, the next question is how it sounds dirty, but also how it responds to the guitar's volume control. So we switched across to the dirty channel on our TH30, and we're gonna play some dirty lines, again, using a cable, then the 100 series, then the 500 series. You'll know which one it is because it'll be the one that's switched on. And we're gonna explore both how it sounds dirty, how it responds to my pick dynamics, and how it responds to the guitar's volume control. And we're also gonna be looking at any additional noise that might be reduced by using a wireless system over a cable. Let's try that now. So one final scenario that we're gonna look at is how wireless units such as this react with a vintage style fuzz. Now, vintage pedals such as fuzzes, some wahs, and treble boosters, basically anything with germanium in them as well, tends not to react terribly well to buffered outputs, such as you would expect to see from a wireless. And in fact, you're generally best off connecting the guitar directly to these units so you can preserve the impedance relationship between your guitar's pickups and said fuzz unit. Now, just to demonstrate that it's not just wirelesses that upset fuzzes like this, we have a buffer on the floor. So we're going to experiment by using our orange fur coat fuzz set to an octave fuzz setting. We're going to play first of all with just a cable, then with a Providence Vitalizer buffer in line, which should greatly upset the fuzz and make it sound very, very spiky and harsh. Then we'll experiment with the 100 series, 500 series wireless. I do expect this probably isn't going to sound terribly pleasant, but bear in mind, this is not so much the fault of the wireless as it is the fault of the vintage pedal. And there is a solution to that, which I'll tell you after this example. But first, fuzz. So while we can agree that's probably not the greatest sound in the entire world, if you are a vintage fuzz or treble booster user, you may be better sticking with a cable. But everybody else, these wireless systems represent a really great sounding and easy to operate solution. However, if you are determined that you're going to use your vintage style pedals and you absolutely must go wireless, a potential solution used by guitar players like Matt Bellamy with his Fuzz Factory, or Brian Mayer with his treble booster, is to mount said pedal on the strap of your guitar and to go from guitar to pedal to wireless, which will preserve the dynamic relationship between your guitar's pickups and the pedal and still give you the convenience of wireless operation. And the plus point with that is most of these vintage style pedals have a very low current draw, which means you'll get away running them on a battery for ages and ages and ages. Now, the all-important question that we haven't answered in this video is how far away from my wireless system can I wander? Because that's, after all, why we buy these things, so we can kind of have a wander around on the stage. And we're going to answer that question in a moment, but first of all, I need to go and grab the assistance of my friend Dan LeGrailey, also from GI Magazine, who's going to give us a hand testing this in the real world. And we're going to go and have a wander around the main streets of Romford with our wireless systems.
All right, guys, we're out on the streets of Romford. We're going to see how far these wireless units get us. My prediction, because I have the expensive unit, is that I am going to be victorious.
See, I'm not sure, you see. You know, it could be, the magic could be in the hands, we'll see, mate.
Well, that's it, man.
Well, I've got your PRS.
You have my McCarty soap bar, I have my Custom 22. We have Rotor Sound 10 to 46, is that right? On each
and
one
we've
of them.
Got the Moore pedals,
the Moore preamps, and we're going to see how far it takes us. Let's go! Turn around, down on the 100 series, only made it to there. But let's be honest, I don't think there is a stage in the land that is that big, so I think you're going to be just okay with either one of these. But in case you're wondering which system had the absolute maximum range, it is of course my 500 series. Anyway, my name's Nick for Guitar Interactive Magazine. That over there was Dan LeGrailey. We'll see you next time.